Hi there, this is a follow-on in my series on the Solartron 7150 Plus multimeter. In the first video, you saw me repairing the power line filter that had exploded, releasing lots of magic smoke, and replacing the rather tired and dim LCD backlight LEDs. This video is about the GPIB interface on the back on the 750 Plus. There are two reasons why I decided to tackle the GPIB before continuing with calibration of the multimeter. I had a look at the calibration procedure and it appears to be rather easier done via the GPIB than from the front panel. The second reason is that since the meter seems to be in spec, at least for DC volts, I wanted to start using the GPIB interface to automate the recording of battery voltages during charge and discharge cycles over many hours. Well, I'm happy to report that building a GPIB to USB interface was quite easy and it works very well. So what's the GPIB bus? The GPIB or General Purpose Interface Bus is a parallel bus using 8 data lines, 5 control lines and 3 handshake lines. That's a total of 16 wires plus 8 ground connections on a 24-pin connector. It uses TTL level and is meant to connect multiple devices in parallel, that is, they all share the same 24 connections. I'm not going into the details of the bus protocol. There are quite a number of places on the internet that do that already. Here's a good site to start with. Each device has a unique 5-bit address assigned, and a bus controller selects which device can become active and talk on the bus and which device can only listen. Not all devices can do both talking and listening, but the Solartron 750 Plus can do both if enabled via these dip switches in the rear. It is negative logic, so you turn off the listener only mode and the talker only mode to enable the full functionality. The other switches select the bus address, in this case 3. Unfortunately, modern computers don't have GPIB interfaces, and the usual method to connect to GPIB nowadays is an external converter that provides GPIB on one side and a serial or USB interface on the other. If you search the internet, you'll find that prices for these converters go from several hundreds of dollars for high-end big names down to about $150. Here's an example of one of the cheaper commercial GPIB to USB interfaces. It's very neat and apparently well made, but still way too expensive. It would be more than double of what I paid for the multimeter. But I don't really need the capability to address many devices in parallel. I only have one in the first place, so I started to look around for DIY alternatives. It turns out there are quite a number of those. After due consideration of the pros and cons, I settled on an approach by Rudolf Reuter. It's a very straightforward approach. Everything is done by an Arduino Nano, and all that's needed are pull-up resistors and some series resistors to limit current in case something goes wrong on the bus. Rudi has put up the code for the Arduino Nano as a free download. This is basically implements a serial interface via USB, so on the PC you communicate with the Arduino Nano as if it were connected to a serial port. Rudi's software implements a simple command interface that allows the PC to send messages to the Arduino to act as a controller and issue GPIB commands and receive responses from the bus. More about the software later. The hardest thing to get was the GPIB connector. I tried to find a 24-pin PCB mounted type similar to what Rudi used on his board, but they were on back order for several months. So I decided to buy a cable type instead and sacrifice an old parallel printer cable that I found from many years ago. After about an hour of concentrated soldering and keeping track of wire colors, the GPIB connector part was done. Now for the termination on the Arduino side. It looks complex, but it's actually very simple. Each wire from the connector, except for ground of course, ends up like the diagram here. A 6.2K pull-up resistor to 5 volts and 120 ohm resistors in series to one of the Arduino Nano's pins. I implemented all of this termination circuitry on a piece of perf board. The resistors had to be put in standing, which meant the joint here is actually a wire bridge raised above the board and easily accessible. The wires from the GPIB are soldered directly onto these bridges. The Arduino end is implemented as a row of PCB connector pins. Because of the limited space in the enclosure, the whole thing is implemented as two rows of 8 termination points. Electrically, they are all the same, and only the color of the cable wire from the GPIB determines what function each terminator has. I choose to put all the data wires on one side and the rest on the other. Here you see the perf board with the terminator resistors and the connector pins already in place, because the cable wires will be permanently soldered on top of the resistors. I added the white piece of ABS plastic to act as a cable guide and strain relief. All cable wires are soldered in. Now is a good time for a thorough continuity check between the board and the GPIB connector pins. Once done, the board is now ready to be mounted in the enclosure. The termination board is now in the enclosure. The Arduino Nano will be mounted on this co-terminal board with the already prepared jumper cables. It will be held in place with the two screws epoxied to the floor. Here you see the finished interface with everything mounted, wired up and ready for the lid to be put on. The USB cable plugs into the Arduino Nano board through the round hole in the side. The USB also provides the power to the Arduino Nano and the termination board, so no further connections are needed. There are a lot of connections, and the key thing to not get lost or make mistakes is to keep track of wire colors, signal names, pins and port numbers, and ticking of connections when they are made and checked using continuity tests. The drawing on the right is the GPIB connector, and the table on the left traces everything from the GPIB function and pin number, the cable wire color, the jumper wire color, the Arduino Nano board pin, and ultimately the I/O port of the RTMaker328P controller chip. This particular wiring scheme, assigning GPIB signals to Arduino ports, is the same one used in Rudi's project, which means you can use his software for the Arduino directly to test it out. To do that, you need to burn the software into the Arduino, of course, and then connect it to a USB port and the GPIB cable to the instrument. Make sure normal GPIB operation is enabled on the 7150 Plus and note the address, which in my case is 3. The GPIB shows up as a serial interface via USB. On Linux, it shows up as TTY USB 0 and you can access it through a simple terminal program such as PuTTY set for the highest possible speed of 115,200. You see here the identification of the firmware version. If you use Rudi's original version, you will not see anything after startup because his version only responds to commands. I thought it'd be useful to send an automatic hello world right after start so you know that the Arduino is working. If you use Rudi's version, you can get the version information by typing capital I followed by control J, which is the line feed character. Capital I, control J. Note that the program doesn't echo anything you type because normally all these commands would be sent by programs and not interactively, so you are typing blind. Also, all characters are case sensitive and there is no backspace to correct any mistakes. If you make a mistake, you need to send it on regardless by pressing line feed to be able to continue. The R command is used to send GPIB commands to a device and get a response. You try this with Rudi's on my version using the GPIB command E to the 7150 plus, which should return a string with all its settings. So, capital R, 3 for the address, comma, capital E, and control J for line feed. The response is a code that is explained in the 7150 Plus handbook. It shows basically all the settings, range, integration times selected and whatnot. The main thing for now is that it shows everything works as it should. It is important not to get confused here with all these commands. There are really two types of commands. On the left are those programmed into the Arduino, that is commands that the USB to GPIB interface box understands. On the right are those a GPIB device, in this case the 7150 Plus, understands. There are actually more commands and I just picked a few that fitted on a page. The 7150 Plus user manual has the complete list. The key thing to understand is that you need to use the commands on the left to issue the commands on the right. For example, if you wanted to switch to resistance mode and 200 kilo ohm range, you would need the command string M2R4. We are not expecting the 7150 Plus to send anything back when you issue these commands, and so you would pick the W command in the table on the left here. The W command needs to be addressed to the 7150 Plus, that is 3, so you would send W3M2R4 line feed on the USB bus. One of the things I wanted to be able to do is simply to log whatever measurement values are shown on the display in a file. This means the instrument is basically free running and remains controlled from the front. The 7150 Plus supports this, and every time it has a value ready for display, it also makes it available on the GPIB. All you need to do is a read command to collect it. For this purpose, I added the H command, which is really like the R command, except that doesn't send anything. This works quite well, but you can't fetch faster than the instrument updates the display. So once per second in 5-digit mode is as fast as you can go, but you can read as slow as you want, because if you don't fetch the value on a GPIB, it gets overwritten with the next one, so you will always get the latest. This here is a link to my GitHub page where you can download the modified software for the Arduino, as well as a little Python program that uses it to sample measurements on the GPIB and log them into a file. Let's try some of this stuff using PuTTY or your terminal program of choice. So we first try H3 to get the current measurement, so that's H3, comma, and then Control J, and we get a value. Switching from ohms to volts and selecting a 200K range, which we do with the command of W3, comma, M2 for the mode and R4 for the range. Then using H3 to get another reading. We see it's a different value, if different range now. Let's get the current settings. R3, comma E. And if you look carefully, you can see that we actually have M2 and R4 selected. We can now go back to an auto range, which is R0. So we go with a white 3, comma R0. And to see the effect, we get another measurement, H3, comma. And we see the range has changed. And now we can switch to DC volts, which is mode 0, W3, comma, M0, and to get another reading, H3, comma, and we're back to volts. Of course, you want to control the GPIB using a software program instead of typing cryptic commands into PuTTY. As a start, I wrote this little locker program in Python. It is command line based and should run on Windows as well. You need, of course, PySerial available because the Arduino interface simulates a serial port. The program basically reads measurement values from the GPIB and stores them with a time since start in a text file that is formatted as CSV, comma separated values, to allow it to be used directly with spreadsheet programs such as Excel or LibreOffice Calc. There's a help available with the usual -h. You can specify the interval time, which is 1 second by default. If you do very long measurements, for example when recording the voltage of a battery while discharging over several hours, you may want to use a higher value to reduce the file size. For example, one entry every 30 seconds. Of course, you may then miss anything interesting that was happening in those 30 seconds. For such cases, I added the delta option. Here you can specify a value by which the measurement must have changed up or down since the last log entry before a new value gets logged. To use this, you set the interval time fairly short, not to miss anything, for example 1 second, and a delta of say 0.1 depending on what range and resolution you use. Then the log will only contain entries when the delta was exceeded. You may need to experiment a bit to find the right delta that filters repetitive and uninteresting values or eliminates noise, but still gets those important changes through. The other options are fairly standard. You can specify the serial port where the Arduino is connected, the file name, if you don't want to use the automatic one, the GPIB address, if 3 isn't the one that you use, and a GPIB command to produce a measurement if your device needs one. To stop the program, use Ctrl+C. You find the program for download on the same GitHub page mentioned earlier where the modified Arduino software for the interface software is. To test the locker program, I used the predefined ECG waveform sample that was available in my function generator. I set the offset so it remained positive with a peak of 5 volts. This is how it looks on a scope at 10 kHz. For testing the logger, I connected the function generator to the multimeter and changed the frequency to 0.005 Hz instead, which means one period takes 200 seconds. The problem with such low frequencies is that it takes literally minutes before the signal repeats itself and you don't know at which part of the waveform pattern you are starting your measurement. Although the pattern should repeat itself after 200 seconds, I run all tests for 300 seconds and I always started the logger and then within a few seconds pressed the sync button on my waveform generator, which although there wasn't any external sync signal connected, is supposed to restart the waveform. The first run uses just 1 second interval and produces a file size with 300 lines and 6.2 kilobytes, of which you see here the first 32 lines. The second run uses 10 second intervals and what you see here is the whole file of just 600 bytes for 5 minutes and you'll notice the increments of 10 instead of 1. The third run is back to 1 second and a delta of 0.1. The file size is about 1/4 of the first one and you can see gaps between the measurements, for example between 5 and 23, where the change was too small to trigger logging. This is how these files look when plotted in a spreadsheet program. The first one is a very accurate plot of the waveform from the function generator. You can see that the second one misses a lot of details, including at least one of the major peaks. The sampling was simply too coarse and it completely skipped over that change. The third one, using the delta function, looks reasonably accurate given that we have compressed the data by 75%. We are not missing any of the major events in the signal. Anyway, this was just a little demo on what the delta option can be used for. It really depends on what you are measuring. I'm very happy how easy and inexpensive it was making this interface work. A big thanks again to Rudy in publishing his original GPIB interface on which my one is based. You find a link to his site in the description below, as well as the link to my GitHub site for the modification and the logger program. The interface is usable for a wide range of devices with GPIB interfaces. I'm using it for the Solartron 7150 Plus multimeter, and as I understand, Rudy uses it to talk to an HP logic analyzer. If you have any GPIB device and were lacking a way of talking to them from a PC, you should definitely consider building one of those. Thanks for watching.